Cool. Well, yeah. So I've been there for 20 years, which is amazing and terrifying. And that's so bizarre that I've been there that long. But I was very lucky. I moved up to San Francisco in 1993. And that was when Toy Story was being worked on. And I had some people that I knew at the company and I would come see and I would go look at the reels every now and then and think like, man, I could maybe do this. But I didn't know what I was doing. And I was very lucky to get in and have a teacher in Joe Rampt. So, like many of you, I was raised on a steady diet of cartoons. These are some of my favorites, Star Blazers, Herculoids. Who likes Herculoids in here? I'm sure there's a Herculoids fan somewhere. Donald Duck, Warner Brothers, you know, all this stuff. Comic books, huge comic book fan. I thought this is what I was gonna do when I was a teenager, wayward teenager, not focused in any way, shape, or form. And I love movies. This is what my parents would do. They would take us to see all sorts of inappropriate, awesome movies. And I was a child of the 70s and the 80s, so this is really the movies that really were a huge influence on me. Time Bandits, are there Time Bandits fans? Yeah, I saw that when I was 11 and my mind was blown. And talk about a dark ending. If you haven't seen this movie, my friend, that has a dark, dark ending. And I was like, I need to see more movies like this. I like that kind of stuff. Jaws, I was around during the end of the whole drive-in theater thing. And so I saw that when I was 6 in the drive-in theater, because your parents just took you to see whatever you went to see. And I remember sitting on the roof of my car, and I was so terrified when this movie was over that I remember my father trying to get me off. It was over, and I was like, I don't want to get off the car. And he's like, there's no water anywhere. I have this very vivid memory of this, but it made me realize what the power of movies can do. And I love Poltergeist, Invasion of the Body Snatchers. I saw when I was 8. That is an awesome time capsule of San Francisco. If you guys ever want to watch this, it's fantastic. Talk about a dark ending. If you haven't seen that, you want to see dark endings, that's good. Killing Fields is another one I loved, or Raiders of the Lost Ark. All these, you know, these are huge influence on me, and never did in my mind at all that I think I would actually work on movies, but I did. Somehow I found my way here. I worked on A Bug's Life, went on to Toy Story 2, Monsters Incorporated, which is where I think Eric worked on this. I think after I had wrapped off the movie. Finding Nemo is another one. I was a huge fan of this. I worked on Ratatouille for a year with a director that got removed. That was not fun, but it happens. Wall-E was another one. I worked on Brave, then I went on to Cars 2, but Cars 2 came out before Brave. It's all very confusing. But loved working on all of these things, and I worked with multiple different directors, different writers, storyboarding the entire time on all of these films. I got to work on The Blue Umbrella. Does anybody see The Blue Umbrella? This is the short in front of Monsters University. I love these shorts you were asking about, the gentleman down here. And this was great, because it's like working on just one sequence for like 9 months. It's like, this is great. There was no script, and I just sort of helped the writer and the director visualize the story he wanted to tell. It was really fun. I did work on this for 5 months, 4 years ago. So the first version of this movie had the Tan Kang in it. I really missed that. I wish they were in it. That was really fun to do. And the last 3 years I've spent working on this, which comes out next year. I don't think anything I did will be in the movie, unfortunately, but that's okay. That's the life of story, is that everything you do just helps make a better story. Doesn't mean that what you do is gonna be on the screen. Before all this, when I moved up here, my first job was on The Nightmare Before Christmas. I was extremely lucky to get on this movie as an assistant 2D animator doing effects work. And so I wanted to show you just one of the scenes that I did. Oh, sorry.
Okay, I wish it was louder, but...
There we go. So I did the assistant 2D animation on these ghosts you see flying around.
Boys and girls of every age, wouldn't you like to see something strange?
Come with us and you
will. Not this stuff, but when the ghosts... So as you can imagine, I was like thrilled to be working on this. It was made in the South Market, San Francisco, and I loved it.
Teeth ground sharp and eyes glowing red.
All right, so that was my introduction. And it was kind of like heroin, like, okay, I want more of this all the time, and this is what I want to do. I want to make movies. And I was very lucky to be here when Pixar was beginning. But when I got into Bug's Life, not everything was easy to do at that point. They were still struggling with technology and whatnot. We still do. And so there's a scene where Rosie throws her web at PT the Flea, and they realized how difficult it was going to be to do. And they knew I had done some 2D effects animation, so I was very lucky to do some 2D animation in this movie. It's a little known secret. There's a little shot that's 2D animated. So, and because of my experience on Nightmare and James and the Giant Peach, it allowed me to be able to be tapped to do this.
Bugs will pay, big bucks to see, a bonfire that is starring me.
PT, look, money!
Where, what?
So that's 2D animation. Yeah, crazy, right? So some poor sucker in the art department had to paint every set frame that I did and put all this motion blur in. And so I had to make sure he knew which rope was in front of the other. And so this is one element. And then when it starts covering, there's two elements here. And he did all that rim lighting and, yeah, made it look all beautiful. That's 2D animation. I wish I could do more, but it's cool. All right, so I thought I'd talk about the process of like how we put these things together. So the idea, three ideas are usually pitched by the person that is picked, by Lasseter and the powers that be. And ideally, one gets going. They might say after you pitch your three ideas, we like two of them, can you still focus on these for a few months? And then we'll come back to you and ideally we'll pick one. And then the development, research, concept work, this can be about a year or so, maybe less, where you're just sort of trying to figure out what it is that inhabits the world of the story you're trying to tell. The writer is brought on, sometimes the director is the writer. That is my favorite because there's less hoops to jump through and you're just dealing with one person. Script process, now we're having a little bit more script-based table reads and check-ins with John. And normally when we started our movies in the past, we would have an idea about what our movie is, but we might not have a full script. But it was very nebulous, and I really enjoyed that because, like, Bug's Life is a good example. We worked on that for 2 years and had no ending. And we just kept on going, okay, we're gonna find this ending at some point. And then a friend of mine came on, and we basically had him go away for a month and said, how about you come up with some ideas for the third act while the rest of us worked on act one and two? They don't like to do that so much anymore. But it was fun, it was great. And a lot of the ideas that he came up with ended up in the movie. So there's this whole process, and then the script is broken down into sequences, and then the story crew, which is someone like myself, comes on to the movie, 6 to 10, usually about 8 is the right number, and the head of story. The head of story is basically the liaison between the director and the story crew, because your story crew needs information, and ideally you're getting it from your director. That's the thing about story I love, is you get a lot of FaceTime with your director. I know Eric was often saying by the end, you don't see the director as much as what you want. But in the beginning, it's just you and the director for a couple of years, usually, if not a year. Then you storyboard the entire film multiple times, screened every 4 months or 8 months, somewhere in that fluctuates, over 3 to 4 years. It sounds insane, but this is how we make the stories better, is that we get all the bad versions out that you guys don't see to get to the good stuff. And it just takes a long time. But if you have somebody who knows what they're doing, Brad Bird is one of them, who can really focus, sometimes you can get through that hurdle that much quicker. But it does just take time. And then, as I said earlier, your 10-pole sequences are picked for production. So ideally by end of year two, you have an idea of what your movie is. It's entertaining, that's really important. People like what it is, care about the characters, and there are a couple of sequences within the movie that are locked, not locked, but close, that then can go into production. That's what you want. I often liken this to building a pyramid. Because, as I said, on Coco, I spent 3 years and nothing I did is going to be in the movie. That's okay, because I'm part of the bedrock, part of the first layers of this movie. There's the producer and the director loading over the story minions. But I do liken every layer as like a screening, potentially. And I had to do this on Cars 2 as a story supervisor. It was not a great experience, but I had to tell those guys, I know this isn't great, but everything you're doing now is you're laying the bedrock to get to the point. Ideally, the point is the end of your movie. So I find that to be helpful. So I know in Coco, I'm somewhere down in layer 20, but I helped them get the movie done. I've heard it said this way. It's like an archaeological dig. And this is a little bit more like what it used to be. We would find our movies. So you'll be digging and digging and digging, and you find a Tyrannosaurus Rex, and you realize, okay, this is the movie we're making. It's a Tyrannosaurus Rex. Yes, okay, great. You know what this is? Great. Everyone keep digging and digging and digging, and everyone keep finding the parts. And then you dig a little deeper and go, wait a minute. Okay, I think it's a Stegosaurus. Oh, this whole time we thought it was a T-Rex. when it's a stegosaurus. Oh, right. Okay. Keep digging and digging and digging. And whoa, wait a minute. I think it's a pterodactyl. Ah, okay, great. We thought this whole time it was this. Now it's kind of leading us. It's a little bit more this. This is a pterodactyl. And you keep on digging. Wait a minute. It's a brontosaurus. Ah, okay, finally. Now we know where this movie is. And then you kind of get to, oh, wait a minute. It's a velociraptor. All this time, we thought it was all these other things. And I like this because basically, even though your movie is a velociraptor, all the other versions of the movie are still part of the DNA of this film. It might be a sequence, it might be a shot, it might be a character. So everything you're doing, again, helps you get to the final version. So I know it's silly, but it helps me not go insane working on these movies for so long. Okay, I don't know if anyone's seen this, but this is Storyboarding the Process by the amazing Joe Rampt. He was my teacher in college and my mentor and really good friend at Pixar. So this is pretty much what I do. That's me, or the story person drawing away. And you're thinking, you're pinning up boards. We do everything digitally now, but this is what it used to be. You're pinning up your boards and you're, okay, how can I make this sequence better? And this is my favorite, because these are all the things that you're thinking of. You're thinking of acting, you're thinking of writing, you're thinking of the editing, the composition, the staging. These are all the things that are going through your mind when you're trying to storyboard a sequence properly. And you're working hard, ideally, throwing your things away, you're self-censoring, putting things around. Ah, yes, okay, now we're ready. And then you pitch. This is a terrifying thing when you pitch to your director and your crew, but it has to be done, because you gotta show it to a bunch of people so you can get better ideas and make it better. And there's John Lasseter, he's thinking, yes, the other directors, yes. And then, he gets an idea. And often a sequence that you do is just to get the juices flowing and a better idea to come out. And then all hell breaks loose. And that would be me sick in the background and everyone's like, yeah, this is gonna be great. And there's constructive arguing and people are pinning and unpinning. I love working this way because it's physical stuff that people are doing drawings. And then the dust settles and there's the aftermath. These are all little post-its. That's what we used to do, is put post-its on storyboards. And he says, all right, great job. And you get up and say, what the hell? Oh my God, I have to do another pass of this. So this would be pass one. And then you go back, okay. And then you go back to work on the second pass. And ideally by the third pass, it goes down to editorial and they edit your work and they put sound effects and music. And this is how we do the entire movie. And ideally after about 4 or 5 months, then we show it to the whole company, and then you tear it all down and reboard. And ideally, after every screening, you're not ripping the entire movie apart, but making it better. I wanted to show this. This was a slide that Steve Pilcher, who was the production designer on Finding Dory, gave me. It was very nice of him. So the storyboards can influence greatly the path of the camera. That's what the blue, green, and red little lines are here. And this is the touch. Did everyone see Finding Dory, maybe? I'm not sure if everyone did, but there's a scene where there's a touch pool they end up in, and everyone's touching these guys, and they're screaming for their lives, little children. And so these storyboards help them map the path of the camera, just to show you guys how storyboards can be very applicable. This is me with the crew of Cars 2, and this is how boards used to be done. We have stacks of these boards everywhere. Here we are looking at some scene or another. I can't remember when. But this is how we do it. We would look at everything, everyone would give notes, and ideally you tackle the notes, and then it gets better as everything gets sent down to editorial. Now it's all digital, and everything is done on a Cintiq. I took this picture because I couldn't remember which cup of coffee was the right cup of coffee I should be drinking to send to my wife. But it's a good example of what I work like now. Everything is done on a Cintiq, and all the storyboards are done in Photoshop, and then we have our own in-house editing software. And if you look around beyond the coffee cups and whatnot, there's a lot of these little sketches here, and this is how I tend to do my work with a lot of thumbnails. So I'll do, every pass I do in a sequence is this, these tiny, tiny little drawings, and I'll do just tons and tons of these, and it's a really good way to draw your way to a solution, I find. I really like working this way. Some people do little notes on their script pages. That's one way of working. But this way I like the best. This is some ideas for a little Luxo promo. So I'm not worrying about all the poses, but just getting the idea out. And this is what I might show a director if I was pitching some ideas. These are some little thumbnails for Brave. And I'll do basically pages, like 40 to 50 pages like this. And I'm sort of self-editing as I'm going along. And then I might sit and actually show these to the director. So this would be like a first pass of a sequence. So this is the way that I like to work. A lot of the newer, younger kids that come around just go straight digital, but they spend, I find, too much time finessing these beautiful drawings when we're gonna be reboarding everything anyway. So Beatboards is one way that I love to work. I love to do these sort of larger images. Up, do you guys know? You guys have seen this. So Up came out in 2009. These were images were done in 2004. So just to show you how early on we started. This was in development when I was helping Pete. I did a little stint in development. And this was really fun. He gave me the ideas about what he wanted to do. And so I did this one quick idea of the house with balloons. We also liked the idea like a ship that had an anchor. It was like literally floating around. And I try to get as much depth as I can, foreground, middle ground, background. And I think this idea is that he lost his wife's hat when flying out the door. So these would be used in the pitch to Lasseter per se or other people just to get an idea about what he wanted to do. And this and these definitely helped. These are the movie he made. And then he loses the house and the anchor makes this big giant divot in the ground. And we love this idea of him chasing the house. You see the dog is there early on, but it had a helmet instead of a collar. And there was a big bird and I think she had an egg that they were trying to save, if I remember correctly. It was a long time ago that I did these. And the bird was supposed to be the last of its kind, and so we were again trying to show, how do we show it's the last of its kind? So I just did a quick drawing of, okay, it goes to its nesting ground, it's the only one there. Really simple ways that we can sell the idea. This is a beatboard from Brave that I did. I think when Mom fell into a bear pit at one point. And I love Photoshop because you can get these sort of out of focus stuff in the foreground and create a little bit of depth. This is some Cars 2 imagery when we killed a car in the beginning of the movie. One way we were thinking about going with an evil Russian car. I also do a lot of drawings on paper. This is a teeny tiny drawing that we scanned in that I just did Photoshop and to a little bit of color and add some snow. So I like doing a little bit of both. I find kind of keeps the flavor of the drawing itself alive. This is another rough, really rough drawing, but again, with a little bit of lighting, a little bit of Photoshop. And then this was an idea about the running of the bulls in Spain, but bulldozers. And these were assets from the Mater's Tall Tales that we were potentially gonna reuse. So again, anything to kind of visually tell your story. So these are just some of the things I've learned, art versus commerce. This is what we're constantly doing. We wanna make great movies, but we're driven by people that own us and what we have to do. So time, it just takes years and years to mold a good film, a long, 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 long marathon. If you're in story, it takes many, many years, many, many versions of the movie. And that's just what it takes often to really make a good story and a strong story. Patience, one needs to dig deep to stay focused on the bumpy road ahead because it often is bumpy. You might have a really good first screening and then a really bad second screening and it just really saps the morale. And then you have to get on to the third screening and you just need a lot of patience. Perseverance for the obstacles that lie ahead. Bad screenings, I've had plenty of those where you have to kind of dig deep and get out of that hole. Low morale, the director changes, this happens, they might remove a director. That's a really, really hard thing to deal with, but you move on and try to make the film the best it can be. And the slight encroaching madness of by like year three, you start to go slightly crazy, I find. And collaboration, learn how to play well with others. The yes and, as opposed to like, that's a terrible idea. You have to just build upon that. Yes, how about this? And so it's days and days of this. The brain trust, as we talked about earlier, this is the other directors that are there to help you make a better movie. And there's an army focusing on the singular idea of making a great film, because by the middle of the production, you have maybe 150 people, if not more, that are there to help you make the best film that you can make. And it's easy to lose your way, but if you persevere, you get to a really good film. I wanted to show you guys a couple of sequences that I storyboarded because I can tell you about it, but I just would like to show you what a scene is like. I was very excited when I worked on this because we had a script, which was unusual back then, and I got to choose what sequences I wanted to work on. So the anglerfish sequence, I was like, yes, please let me try this. I think we know how we can do this. This was done before Photoshop, so I drew all of this in the negative and then went to the color Xerox machine and made them all look like they were in the dark. It was very challenging, but really fun to do. And it doesn't differ too much from what the final product is like. They are looking for a license plate in this version, not a diving mask. You'll see. And you'll hear some scratch dialogue and some dialogue from Ellen DeGeneres in the voice.
Look, over there. Do you see that?
I see it.
I'm freezing. Let's get closer. Maybe it's warm, huh?
What is it?
I have no idea. I can't seem to stop looking at it.
And you can see the board count on the bottom.
So
That's After Effects.
The plate! I just saw the plate!
What plate?
The plate we're looking for!
We're looking for a plate?
Yeah!
Okay, I can't see a thing.
Just stay where you are. It's right around here somewhere. It was right here.
Whoa, something's touching me. Something's got me.
That's me. I'm sorry.
Hey, look, a license plate.
Quick, read it and I'll distract him.
Distract who?
Him!
Sorry, but could you bring him closer? I kind of need the light. That's great. Keep it right there.
What does it say?
Well, if you could just maybe hold it steady.
Just read it.
Okay.
Shiny. Sydney.
Sydney, the first word, Sydney. Thank you very much. Okay, number two. Light, please. Second word's new. Sydney's new. Suit.
Hurry.
South. Sydney's new south. Three down. Last word is...
Sydney, the New South Whale? What does that mean?
I don't know.
So I had a blast working on that. It was really fun. Thank you. And it doesn't differ too much in terms of camera angle from the final product. So you can see when the anglerfish reveals itself, it's very similar to what it was staged in the final product. The looking down at her when she says, yes, that's great. Even though it's not a license plate, it's pretty much the same angle. So that's really what we're striving for in story, is to storyboard these images so they can go right through production. And that's ideally what you want. And then you see this shot here where she's in the foreground and he's in the background being chased. And it's pretty much exactly the same setup, even though she's angled in a different way. So you can see the direct correlation with storyboarding and how it really helps to the final product. Because ideally, the rest of the pipeline doesn't have to rethink how the scene is staged and the angles are. So another version is this old opening of Cars 2. Again, stepping across the line, we like to sort of push the limits. This is a different way we wanted to open the movie, and I had a lot of fun. I was the soup on this, and I didn't get to storyboard a lot, but this was one of the few sequences I did. I just wanted to show you guys an alternate version of what the opening might have been like.
Agent Austin Healy, over. I'm being pursued by multiple vehicles, requesting backup.
Roger that, Agent Healy. Currently trying to make your location, over.
Looks like I'll have to pick this up a bit. Do try and keep up, boys. Identify yourself.
Oh.
Captain.
You'll never catch him. He will stop you.
We will see.
It was worth a try. Worth a try. So we like the idea of like putting the stake in the ground and really showing the stakes of like how evil this guy could be. And obviously they were like, I don't know if we can open the movie this way. But it's a nice little showpiece. So you can see the board count, our board counts go really high. By the end of the movie, they can be anywhere from 60 to 90,000 by the end. And those are the numbered boards. All right. That is my ending point, and I will pass it on to Eric.